Beautiful sunny Samaritz. We're high in the Engadin Valley in the historic town of Samaritz. Down in the valley below lies the village of Celerina, and on the woody track between the two, for over a century, men and women have been sliding down ice. Hello everybody, I'm Martin Haven, ready for the two-man bobsleigh competition here. A little bit of a windy afternoon in Samaritz, but we can expect the Swiss fans to be electrified by their hero in two-man, Beat Hefti, who won last weekend in Winterberg. We come to the Samaritz track, the longest, the fastest, the most historic, the oldest, and the only remaining natural ice track. It's a great venue for starters. The temptation is to run it very far down into this first kink. You've got to smoothly come around there. Avoid this little tap on the wall and try and get through the second kink again. No steering, runners must be absolutely straight. Here you're doing about 30 miles an hour. Speed lost here will haunt you all the way down. Through the first significant corner at wall, and then into a two-part corner, snake one and snake two. See how violent the transition can be into sunny, one of only two corners with a permanent wall behind it. Nash and Dixon, named after the 64 Olympic gold medal winners from the UK who were members of the Bob Club. Here and then Horseshoe, high, diving out into Telephone, Shamrock, and Devil's Dyke, built slightly different every year, this year causing real problems for the drivers. Into Nameless, and then the fast four corners down at the bottom. Bridge, Leap, and Gunter Sachs that leads them onto the long straight down to the finish corners. Martineau and Portago over 85 miles an hour, pulling nearly 4 Gs through these two turns as they rush towards the finish line in just around a minute and 10 seconds. Well, the track built new every season, so subtle nuances, and they will have to learn those afresh every year. Stephen Holcomb is our World Cup points leader with 4 wins this season, all of them on the North American Trail. Came in 7th place after a disappointing time in the two-man in Winterberg, his bogey track last week, but he will look forward to joining the field here in Samaritz, a place where he's had much better fortune. Well, hello, everybody. I'm Martin Haven. Sitting alongside me is bobsleigh standout and our analyst here, John Morgan. And John, always so good to come here to Samaritz for sliding.
A privileged venue for any bobsledder who's ever came here, spectator, where the sport was born and raised, where the sport progressed from the 1880s to now. It's an unbelievable atmosphere and venue. If you're a bobsled fan, you have to make this, put it on your wish list.
Corey Buttner cleared last night to race today. He'll have Andreas Dreibel behind him as they go first off the hill. We've got 24 sleds in the field, so the 23 sleds in the field. So the first point will be which of our three sleds do not get a second run, because only the fastest 20 will carry on into the second and deciding heat. A crash in four-man last week, a crash in training. Both have set Corey Buttner on the back foot, but he's had a runaway season so far in two-man and four-man. 2 bronze medals in the last 2 two-man races with Andy Dreibel in the sled behind him. Buttner is looking to recover some of that lost momentum. And John Morgan, he needs to find his mojo here again in Samaritz and try and take another medal.
He medaled last week in Winterberg with the two-man. He was what I call crazy fast, 15th, 16th best start time. And, you know, to have those type of downtimes with that start time on a 1,300-meter track, he's done this last year in Sochi. He had the 21st best start time and finished 6th at the test in Sochi, and it with a different type of a sled. Here he's driving the BMW sleds, last year the Bodine sleds. So when you could achieve great downtime with suspect start times, you got some talent. He's had a rough couple of weeks. Crashed in four-man in Winterberg, crashed in four-man in training here in St. Moritz. I don't think he will compete in four-man tomorrow.
No, I think you're right. He didn't do enough training runs to be allowed into the race. 105.9 kilometers an hour. That translates to 66 miles an hour. And John, at this stage, the sled is really accelerating hard. They'll be touching 80 four corners later.
good lines here on the bottom. A little bit of mistake up there in the nameless curve. Now 138 kilometers, 86.3 miles an hour track record. Corey Buttner, Andreas Travel. Brian Scheimer not happy with that run because he knows there was a few nicks.
Yep. Well, Corey made a couple of brushes with the wall, a couple of little taps, all take speed out of the sled. Andreas Dreibel on the back of the sled for the first time here, and Corey, yeah, nothing wrong with that bone dome.
Start. Corey looks like he's a little bit over the bar. Andreas, great athlete behind him. A lot of left to right movement in that head, but U.S. coaches are really, really high in the power and energy that he projects as the brakeman. And here's one of those taps. When he hits there, then he's got to drive in the middle of the next curve.
That's good.
A lot of steering. Oh, he just said, pointed to his head. He says, concussion, it's all good.
All good indeed. Now then, Ben Hefti, gold medalist last week. Third time on the podium this season. Home ice for him and Alex Baumann. Start record is almost guaranteed.
There it is.
There it is.
5-11. Start monsters, home track. Won the event last week in Winterberg. He was just hanging out in North America, just being a little bit of a tourist. Now he's here in Europe, and he's going to get a little bit more serious in the next month.
Swiss championships were held here a couple of days after Christmas. He didn't compete, didn't feel the need to interrupt his rest routine in this hectic Olympic year. So this is really the first time he's been in action on this track since almost the start of the season.
Well, low line there. Speed, half second advance, 106.5. That's similar to
that. That's good speed.
Good speed. He's got a big start advantage, home field advantage, and he's got great drive lines, unlike Buttner did. And the Buttner tapped a couple times down here. Beat Hefti, the winner of last week's event. He'll look good next week in Innsbruck. He'll probably win that event because he always does.
Here, 39.9. Very good speed at the bottom, and another track record, 106.74. The records
That's
today
fast.
Stood since the Swiss Championships. Gregor Baumann set them, winning the gold medal in two-man. As we said, Hefti wasn't there, and he's now shown what pace he is capable of.
He beat Buttner by 17 hundredths at the start. That should be 54 hundredths at the bottom, but it was really 72 hundredths. So he outdrove Buttner down the track, too, besides establishing the season end start record. You know, him and Alex Baumann are quite a formidable pair. How's it feel to be at home?
They beat the track record by 2 seconds, just. Thomas Florschutz of Germany with the beast that is Kevin Kuska closest to us on the back handles. If you want a copybook definition of explosive power, Kuska is it.
Huge strides, big man. Watch him get in, get down, get behind that sled. 5.18, that's not bad. That gives Florschutz the chance. This is a wily veteran. That sled looks different, doesn't it? The front of that sled, the black, that looks something.
Yeah. I wonder if they've been doing
some
work.
Well, they could have brought a different piece of equipment here to St. Moritz because this is a little different than those artificially cool tracks we compete on the rest of the circuit. He's only 18 hundredths behind. Now, perfect lines here. He's going to have to match Hefti's time, speed on the Exeter Horseshoe, and then it'd be game on.
Olympic silver medalist, last time out in Vancouver in two-man, took fourth in the four-man, 107. Here we go. If that's a new nose on the FES sled, it's working, baby. It's working.
Skid down 19. He might run out of track, but he's not going to let Hefti just blow the field away here. These are great lines by the veteran. Oh, as soon as I said that, he taps. 138.5, does not have the speed. And he will stay in second, 30 hundredths out. 34. Yeah, that little tap out of Gunnar Sachs and, Christoph.
Not so much Jarv Erling from Langen today.
No, he didn't. He had it going, though. You know, he got beat at the top by 700s. That's 21 hundredths at the bottom. He's 34 hundredths at the bottom down, so it means he'd got Hefti outdrove him.
Yep.
But I think the tap here is the high-speed part of the track. That tap there, look, ooh, there's the first mistake. Down below, horseshoe, three or four corners. And then here, looks like the back end's a little bit of a skid. No speed. And this is down approaching Gunter Sachs. Sled comes out, and this is where he set himself up for that next bump.
There's Thomas on the right, Kevin Kuska on the left-hand side, René Spies former two-man standout for Germany, helping with the sleds. Lyndon Rush of Canada with Lascelles King Brown on the back of the sled. Such a battle going on in the Canadian setup to be top dog at the moment in two-man. It's still Chris Spring.
Great start there. They tied Hefty.
The King. Wow. Lascelles Brown. Wow. I mean, it's tough to stay close to Hefty. He hasn't done that all year. Lyndon Rush has been 500, 600, 700 off of Hefty's times. If that is a telltale sign of what Lyndon Rush is focusing on, watch out.
In World Cup points, Lyndon Rush...
Oh, look at that. There's some stuff for the track.
...straddled it, luckily. Lyndon Rush and Chris Spring are tied in the standings.
Speed, 107 kilometers plus. It'll be a big deal here. 106.9, knock, so tap there, too.
Faster than Hefty, though, at that stage, and still with a fractional advantage. Lyndon Rush is producing one of the best drives that we've seen from him in about 24 months.
140 kilometers? No, 138.5. I gotta believe he's gonna fall back to red numbers.
It's gonna be so close at the line. It was just a fraction.
It is still
a fraction.
Did not have the speed. Did not have the speed down there that Hefty had. He was about a half a kilometer down. That mistake up, I think it's before No Name.
Yeah.
Tree, that crossover transition, he hit right before the take on. But he's not the only person doing that. We saw that throughout the women's race. Look at the sled come up in the air. And I've been sort of telling the Canadians that's a no-no. They're laughing at me. They're telling me not, but look at the tap here. That's it. That's the 400s there. Pushes him into the middle of the curve. Then he's got to drive on the late part of the curve. But Lyndon, nice run.
Nice run from Lyndon Rush to lie second behind Baird Hefty. Just 400s separate our top two. Chris Spring of Canada, as we said, no points separating Chris Spring and Lyndon Rush in two-man as Canadian top dog. Jesse Lumsden, the world push champion and longtime partner in the FIBT TV booth, on the back of Chris's sled this season. And Spring, what a standout year this man is having in Canada's sleds, two and four-man.
Jumps in. Quickly start 5:13, very respectable. The race within a race, the three Canadian sleds all going mano a mano every single event. They're trying. Spring is now the Canadian one designation. But what Lyndon Rush just did, Lyndon might have said, it's enough. I'm the guy that won the bronze medal at the last Olympics in four-man bob for Canada.
Still 200s. That's the start deficit only. What a drive Spring is having here.
Tech sleds, watch the speed, 107 plus will give him the lead at the bottom.
Silky touch.
Cutter, no, speed's down.
106.3, Lyndon was 106.9. Lyndon was 138 and a half.
Plus eight, bleeding.
Eight hundreds off the lead, that's 400s behind Lyndon Rush.
Bleeding more time, it's gonna need at least 138 middle to have a chance here.
Oh, he does. He's a little quicker.
Got good speed here, so he could eat into this deficit.
He could tie with Lyndon Rush at the bottom.
Ooh, third, right behind Rush. That was perplexing because he had better speed than Rush did.
Well, you can make mistakes, can't you, down the straight that aren't reflected in the speed gun and through those last couple of corners if you have a bit of a wave. It won't help. Jesse Lumsden now having to push the sled up the hill as well as down it.
I tell you, the most impressive stat after we watched this replay, he gets up there high, does not touch, and now says, I'm going to slingshot myself down the bottom part of the track. Look at Lumsden, how he's buried in the back for aerodynamics. And now look at the sled crossover. And he did have a good slingshot effect on that line.
Chris Spring.
Hey, everybody. It was okay. Second run, trust me.
Chris Spring lies third, Lyndon Rush second. Leader is Baird Hefty. Nick Cunningham and Stephen Holcomb, the next two sleds on the track here, part of this epic US driver battle to be top dog. Holcomb is the World Cup points leader, but for the second spot in the team, Corey Butner lies third in points. Nick Cunningham in fifth place in the two-man, positions reversed in the four-man.
Cunningham also coming off a crash in Winterberg last week. Abe Morlew on the brakes for Cunningham this time. 519. Let's see what he can do here with this new BMW sled. The girls, the USA girls, had a lot of problems up here in the wall curves keeping these BMW sleds straight. Jamie Grubel, the only one with a chance to win a medal. She was the second place into the first run, fell the fourth. Still a great result for her. Cunningham 2/10 back. Needs to have the perfect line into horseshoe.
Well, Steve Holcomb from Utah, close to the Utah Olympic
touch
Park,
the lip.
Touch the wood. But the other two Canadian U.S. sliders, both from California.
Big tap there. Telephone, Devil's Dyke, I think it is, that curve there. 2300s down. Not great, but better than his teammate. If he gets some good 138 and change speed here. Ooh, swing there.
139.5, second Whoa. Quickest sled.
Whoa, he tapped
what
again,
speed.
Though. Uphill.
You can lose it all between Martino and Portago, but what a good run.
And most importantly, he just beat Florschutz.
Yeah, the man from Monterey, California.
That was
long way from the beach.
A clean run.
Yeah.
And boy, did he find some speed on the bottom. And then in the finish area where he hit, that's an where they start going uphill. Here he taps the wood at the top. Hello. Then a little ricochet rabbit out of there. Look at the runner tips. Let's see if he starts turning these things down. He's got the line. There's the runner tips going down. Look at that. You can see him steering. What pictures they're providing us. That, I've never seen that. Now this is going uphill. And he taps the right side of our screen. That was worth 400 or 500 of a second there.
Yeah,
going uphill. You can't do that going uphill.
No. Cunningham looks pretty happy with that slide. He lies in fourth. Steve Holcomb straight out of the blocks with Chris Vogt on the back of the USA One sled, another of these new BMW sleds.
518.
Quicker than Cunningham.
Holcomb was winning all those races in North America. He had the best start or the second best start. Here he's 600, 700, 800 off the pace. And Chris Vogt was at least on the brakes for two of those, one if not two of those four gold medals. Chris Vogt, third place at the World Push Championships behind the King and Jesse Lumsden. Lines, how high will Steven go? Medium. What kind of speed is he gonna have here? Not bad. Doesn't have the 107 the Florschutz had, but if he can get some speed going like his teammate Cunningham just did on the bottom, and he's eating into the clock here.
Here we go, Bert Hefty, the race leader. Steve Holcomb still in the red. Will it go green before the end of the run?
139 speed, he's got
very
that.
Very good,
down to 12.
Just a whisker slower than Hefty.
This looks like second, maybe.
Could be in
third place.
106.86.
Yeah, he lost that at the start. He's 700s, he's 1200s down to Hefty, and he's 800s down to Rush, but he's 700s down at the start to both of them. He drove the better sled. He got beat at the start. Look at the lines. Good. Chris Vogt, can't see him back there. How does he do here at a Gunner Sachs in the speed part of the track? Well, he couldn't match Hefty's time, but he has the second best time. He improves at the start. He's got a chance to win the race.
Well, Holcomb is our World Cup points leader. Four straight wins to start the season pre-Christmas. And of course, he's the 2- and 4-man world champion from 2012. Alexander Zubkov of Russia reunited with his talisman, Alexei Vaivoda, last weekend for the first time in, I'm thinking, probably nearly three seasons since they had a massive falling out. And he needs that power going into Sochi. Yellow visor to cut down the white-on-white glare.
It's a very large human being. Ooh, he jumped in there. I think he caused the sled to wave a little bit. 519. You know, Zubkov's won here before, too, man. He's got more success in four-man, but he's always close to the podium. And the reason is because he's such a good driver. At 38, 39 years old. As I say that, he had a lot of pressure on the exit of wall there into the first part of the snake. 1500s, that's relative to the 700s at the start, usually gets to 15 then. Now you have a chance to eat into it if he's perfect on the exit of horseshoe.
Silver medal last weekend behind Bert Hefty, our current leader.
Speed?
Good speed, 106.7, second only to Florschutz and Hefty.
Levin, he's eating into it. Levin, so now he's going to need that 139.7 or 8 to have a chance to move ahead of a couple sleds.
Oh, tap on the wall.
Yeah, he's got the best speed. He's tied hefty. This could be second.
Going to be very close to the leader,
third.
Just 700s behind. Lyndon Rush, 400s behind. 700s of a second cover the top three.
That tap, you heard Luter say, that tap there on the exit of Gunnar Saxon. You know, Pierre never made a mistake. He just won.
Yeah,
and
enough.
If he lost, it wasn't his fault. Yeah, and, somebody beat him. But, you know, his driver got the same attitude. Here's a mistake. Look at the right side of our screen. He should be in the middle here. Now he's got to cross over and steer to get on the takeout of the first part of Snake. Steering, when it's slow, not good. Here's the tap. And down at Gunnar Sachs, this is the 84 mile an hour speed. And watch this tap on the left side. Doesn't sound like much, but when you're dealing with hundreds of seconds, plus he got a skid going there too.
Yeah, love you too.
Talk about mellow.
Oskars Melbardis of Latvia. Talk about mellow. Talk about quick. He and Dalmas Driskins could well be the new start record holders in 5 seconds.
Jeez, I guess look how big these guys are. Well, you know,
5'12".
Hello. you know, but he doesn't have the experience that the other guys that are leading have. But he's what, 23?
That's absolutely right. And in the last Olympic Games in Vancouver, he was a brakeman, not a driver. So he's giving away a decade of ice experience to guys like Hefty, like Holcomb, like Zubkov.
Latvians have always done well on this track. More so in four-man than two-man. There's a drift.
Now, his first World Cup season, he started the four-man race in 18th, 20th, 22nd, was third quickest at the end of the run, showed then as a driver just what electrifying starting could produce from him. Mistake there is going to cost him, though.
Still a work in progress.
Avoids the wall, 138.8. He's still got the numbers at the bottom.
Remember these names right here.
Yeah.
And he won the Olympic test, the pre-Olympic test in Sochi, in four-man bobsled, which didn't make a lot of Russians happy. Russians and Latvia's got a little cross-border issues.
I think he may be in the middle of their dartboard in the Russian dressing room somewhere. Just
seventh place, about what we expect. Here's up the top before you get to Horseshoe. Little tap there. That forces him over here. You see the runners. Now he's trying to get on where he can choose where he wants to get on and off the curve. He corrected pretty well. Now the bottom part of the speed tracks down to Nameless and Bridge.
Big skid.
Look at that skid there. Bang. You know, when you're dealing 85 miles an hour, that scrapes a few things off. And there's a very large man.
Yeah.
Horseshoe, he's saying.
Yeah. He didn't like the exit. Francesco Friedrich now is our two-man junior and senior world champion. He's also the four-man junior world champion, by the way. Won the title on this track last year with Yanis Becker behind him.
Had the four best starts in the competition last year. That's how come he beat Hefty. He's, what is he, 23, 22, 20?
Yeah.
I mean,
23 years old from
Altenburg. It's unbelievable that they just keep producing these talented athletes. But no, one thing is to be huge and powerful like Melbardis just came down the track. This kid's 40 pounds lighter than Melbardis, but he's got special talent. He's got what you need to be atop of the German Federation. 1100s to the good. 107.2, best speed. This is why he won the World Championships last year.
Silky touch. He looks about 18. He is the baby-faced assassin of men's bobsleigh.
And he's a very great ambassador for the sport. Friends of everybody. This is a tap. 15, 139.2.
Oh.
Not the speed, but still will be the leader.
Yes,
single digits.
A world champion.
10.
Wow.
Track record.
Jawohlmeister.
Christoph Langen, always so hard to read, I think, as a coach, isn't he? You never know what he's thinking.
Well, he won all four heats last year in the World Championships. I'm pretty sure about that. And here he doesn't have the best start time. There's Rennie Spies. Look at what he's got at the bottom.
Look
Rennie
at the Spies, smile.
Matthias Hofner. Oh, my God, what coaching. Look at this line. Look at the monster in the back, just perfectly positioned.
Yeah.
You know, Yanis Bakker perfectly positioned back there. Look at him lean a little bit, and the exit to the slingshot effect on the bottom. That's why he had the best speed. Look at the smile. Hello.
There you go. That is your baby-faced two-man assassin. Yanis Becker leads from Baird Hefti. That's the 1-2 in last year's World Championships here in Samaritz. So, two-minute break on the track to allow for network to take its advertising break. And that means that chance as well for those down at the Horseshoe Bar to get a little bit of lunch in. Lucky them. Francesco Frigic then beat Hefti 1-2 here, as they were in the World Championships last year. The man who took the bronze in the two-man Worlds was Thomas Florschütz. Disappointing run from him. 44 hundredths off the lead after just one heat. He lies ninth out of the 10 sleds that have gone down so far. Now, we heard from Kathleen Martini at the end of the women's race. Because the track was so much different today, especially after being polished up by two skeleton runs, she said it was a lot more skiddy, the weather was different, and she changed the runners that she'd used in qualifying, made a different selection. She said it was a little bit of a gamble, but it worked out well for her. She said, I had the right choice of equipment on. And the runners work within certain temperature parameters, so it's unlikely that you'll use a very cold set of runners or a very warm set of runners here, but she clearly used a slightly different setup. She might have gone for fat runners at the front and thinner runners at the back instead of having fats and fats or thins and thins. So just a little bit to change the feel of the sled, and that worked well on a track that had been polished up by having all the skeleton athletes going down as well. And of course, now when the men meet the track, very different from training. We've had two heats of women's bobsleigh, two heats of women's skeleton, and now we're gonna have two heats of a two-man bob. So by the end of the afternoon, the track will feel very different from the way it was in the warmer training days. Lots of fans there up at the start area. Great track here. You can walk down and lean on the track wall pretty much its entire length and really enjoy world-class bobsledding. Lots of fans watching from the top of the track here as we get ready for our 11th starter in the 23-sled field, round six of the two-man bobsleigh World Cup. Justin Cripps with Brian Barnett behind him in the Canada two-man sled. And Cripps, another standout brakeman who converted to the front seat. John Morgan, that's the way this sport is going. Power breeds speed.
But in essence, that's the way it's always gone. All the brakemen have all been the ones that have the talent to go forward do. And I could think back, I saw Eric Scher here yesterday and his brother Peter. They were both on the World Championship sled in 1973, Rennie Stadler. And then from that, they were both the Swiss number one and two drivers at the next two Olympics. And Scher went on to win the Olympic gold medal, win five or six World Championships. But you could take a story like that of all of these people. They all started in the back seat, and then they got the passion to go to the front. And the thing is, when you go to the front seat, you have to go with athleticism. Justin Cripps is an athlete, and he'll figure it out eventually. But if you look at the physical specimen he is, just a matter of time before he figures it out.
And again, it's time on the ice, and that's so hard to come by. You can't just pound round and go down the hill for days on end like you could do in a racing car and a racing track to fine up your skills. It's a very finite period of time you can actually be on ice. Half a second behind at the moment. This could put him in 10th place ahead of the USA's Corey Buttner. Again, two tenth. Younger drivers learning their craft.
It's three Canadian sleds in the top 10.
Can't argue with that, can you? That's a Canadian program.
Three Americans in the top 11. Germans, we have three Germans in there.
And our race leader, perhaps, Francesco Frigic, never was a brakeman, so he's one of those exceptions.
Look at that knock between Nash and Dixon. He's still struggling here on the exit of Dixon going into Horseshoe. This cost him a serious amount of time with that skid.
So sled being lifted out. Very manual sport, bobsleds. Not an awful lot of glamour, even here in Samaritz. Cripps will go away, analyze the errors, and try and eradicate them. Maximilian Arndt is our four-man world champion. Hasn't had quite the season in two-man. Best result of the year so far, seventh place in the Lake Placid encounter.
Well, because he's a very good driver. Track like Lake Placid, Altenburg, St. Moritz. He can give up a lot of time at the start and still use the eye-hand coordination that he has, which might be the best on the planet, and manufacture speed at the bottom for a good result. On these short 1,200-meter, 1,300-meter tracks like Winterberg last week, I think he finished 12th.
Yep.
13th last week. So he's got 11th, 10th, 11th, 7th in Lake Placid, 13th. I believe he's going to get some good speed here in the bottom. I think he's going to get into the top 10, unlike what he's done in the previous four, five events. In the two-man, the four-man, he's the best in the world.
In the four-man, he's the world champion on this track and looking really strong. Little bit of a tap there coming through telephone. 106.2 is the third or fourth fastest speed we've seen. Need to be up in 107s, really, to challenge for the medals.
Well, let's see. I think he made a mistake on the exit of Horseshoe. It's going to prevent him from getting the 139-kilometer speed, 86 mile an hour down here. He gets it, 139.3, 86.6. This should be easy top 10.
Touch on the wall as well, seventh place.
This is where he is, seventh in Lake Placid in the same field. Mm-hmm. Seventh here. This is about where he'll finish. And this just tells you that it's not all about start time here. Yes, you have to have the massive start to have a chance to win a medal. But here, a guy like Arndt can hang out in the top 10 with a problem at the start. But then here, look at the runners. Look how much those runners are steering right there. Boy.
Tiny adjustments, but it's the tap here in telephone that's going to cost him. Look at
that. He's the only guy. Everybody else tapped on the left side. He taps on the right wall. He's the first guy so far on the right wall. Look at that. Great. Look at the pictures we're getting here. Unbelievable. Usually they're tapping on the left side. So he found some fine line through that curve.
Still just 26. Remember when he was the fresh-faced young kid? Now he's starting to look like a veteran. Alexander Kazyanov with Max Belugin, 13th of our 23 sleds in this sixth World Cup race of the two-man season. Kazyanov lying 13th in world ranking, 7th in Calgary. The only top 10 finish for him after that was 10th place in Park City, Utah. So he's been a 10 to 15 man for the rest of the season.
He's more of a four-man specialist, like the guy who just came down the track, Max Arndt. He's medaled in Park City in four-man. He's been hanging out in the shadows of Mr. Zubkov for the last 4 years, and I say it, and I'll say it again. He's one of my dark horse names that you don't expect to win a medal in Sochi. I think if he gets any kind of a start in the four-man at Sochi, he's going to medal.
Of 30 years old to the 39 of Zubkov, so you could imagine maybe certainly one more Olympic cycle, maybe two.
At least one, but I got to believe the Russians are going to go out and recruit athletes who could push the two-man and the four-man at a level that you see beyond hefty.
Well,
and
listen,
that's what they want.
When the Olympics is on the TV, as the U.S. found after Salt Lake, they're not going to have to recruit. They're just going to have to filter the athletes that are coming to the sport.
Well, there's so much track and field emphasis that have entered the sport in the women's program. And I think the same will come through, like you just said. Sixth!
Wow. Good
run. That's awesome. He had the 11th best start time, the 6th downtime. Mr. Kasanov, you just reaffirmed that you are a great driver. Because if you could drive well, even with a bad start, you get rewarded on this track.
900s of a second only slower than Alexander Zubkov, the lead driver. Zubkov started 519, he started 522. So he matched Zubkov for the drive all the way down.
Little tap there. That's telephone. Shamrock, I think.
Transition into Devil's Dyke is causing all sorts of dramas today. So Kazyanov should be pretty happy with that. Next up is Loic Costaigne of France with Romain Heinrich behind him. Costaigne's back showing the scars of getting spiked as they loaded last week in the two-man. Don't want to stand on the sled, that won't help. And this young Frenchman, John, broke into the World Cup last year, put in a couple of sensational performances at the end of the year, and he's had some good runs this year as well.
Yeah, but that was a real rough entry into the sled by the brakeman. Had a good conversation with his teammates that they're... I was going to talk about they're really not satisfied with their four-man sled, and they're out looking. I think they tested a Swiss sled this week at four-man. But they've been on the tour. They've had some success in North America that surprised a lot of people. And they've got Canal Plus, French media, following them around, which is great. And we just need France, you know, in the sport. We need France in the sport. And so it's great to see this young kid come to the table like this.
Rocky transition from telephone to shamrock, and he's skidding around at the bottom of the track. He hasn't got the setup right on the sled. It's too flighty, and it's skidding away much too often here. He might struggle to make the second heat, 14th. He's the slowest of our sled so far. 137 is only, I say, 85.4 miles an hour.
Go take a ride at 85 miles an hour.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and with your rear end about 6 inches off the ice, you get the sensation of it.
This is the smoothest bob track of all. It's such a great place to take a trip down.
So many people have said, hey, we'll just do the whole World Cup here all winter. We don't save on travel expenses.
Well, it might cost us an arm and a leg in the bar, though, John. Yeah. That's the only problem.
You had to bring that up. A little late coming off the curve there. When the energy makes him late, he goes left to right. The sled's not going forward, and he still hasn't caught up with it. He's late for two or three more corners. Watch him tap here. No, that wasn't bad. He got on that curve right there pretty good.
But he's got no height at all in Devil's Dyke.
Because he didn't have the speed.
But he's a real prospect for the future, this kid. Simone Bertazzo of Italy, our taxi driver last night, was asking how the Italians were doing. I think we broke it to him gently, didn't we, that they're not necessarily going to win a medal here today.
Well, this Simone Bertazzo won a bronze medal here in the World Championships in 2007. He is, you know, very talented, eyes and hands, but when you have the 13th best start, 1,400s down, he's got to hit a home run every time he comes down the track, and that, right away, it's not a home run. Now he's got a, looks like an extra base hit going, maybe, for anybody who knows baseball, but that's a tap. That's, for a golfer, he's on the verge of making a bogey here. You know, he's got to have a birdie every time out because he gets that deficient start time.
Half a second back at Sunny, that's less a third of the distance down this track. He could be well over a second adrift at the bottom.
Perfect lines, but he's way off the base.
Oh dear, 106.3, that's not great speed. Again, you can barely hear any noise from the sleds on this track. The artificial tracks echo all the way down. The concrete channel vibrates here. It takes kind of a lot more force to vibrate this mountain.
Yeah, this looks like 13th place. Skid going to that uphill section. There it is. Antonio Tartaglia on the left. Wolfgang Stampfer on the right, their Austrian coach, who I used to have put in the speed merchant fraternity on this track. He always had big speed any place he went.
Yeah.
He gave up time at the start, but Simone, the guy who won a bronze medal here in 2007, we're a long ways from that. Speed on the bottom part of this track, and watch the mistake he makes here going uphill. Watch the skid. He's going uphill. It's severe uphill right here. Cameras doesn't show it. Look at the skid he's got going.
Skid.
Can't do that on that. You know, one thing is to be going downhill. You're going uphill. You got Mother Nature working against you twice.
Brakeman really feeling that. Well, next up, Ivo de Bruin of the Netherlands and Dem Wintersberger. His brakeman is a brand new addition. He got a phone call during the week last week saying, hey, Dem, what are you doing? Not much. Why? You're pushing for me. Come on. And he did the same last week, dropped in, and same last season at the end of the season as well. He's a track cyclist, motorcycle racer. And as he says, I'm not the fastest, but at least it means that Ivo knows he has to drive even harder.
His hands just came off the push bar. That just doesn't have the experience. He's in the same time as Ivo de Bruin, and this could potentially be the worst start time of the race, and it has been. Ivo de Bruin, if you talk to Ivo de Bruin, you think that he's the leader of the pack. He exudes a lot of confidence. He's not cocky. He has a great presence about him, but boy, I would personally just like to be able to see Ivo do better.
He's the better Dutch driver of the two between him and Arnold van Kalke this season, though, but he's not getting his old brakeman back, Braw, the number one sort of brakeman for the Netherlands.
Well, he was just sideways all over the top of the track. And a lot of steering here. And he's a second and a quarter down, and he's going to relegate himself to having a lot of luck to get into the top 20 for a second run. You feel for him. I mean, this is the type of athlete you want representing your country and your sport. And I thought he was poised to really have a good breakout year last year. Just has not advanced.
Well, he came up through the ranks with Braal van der Zijde. They were a team of two. They started in Europa Cup, worked their way finally into World Cup, and now they've been separated by the Dutch coaches. Braal is on the Edwin van Kalker sleds, and he has lost his you know, his equal in pushing, Ivo de Bruin. And so now he's struggling to ring up friends from back home who ride bikes as a living
to
come and push.
Watch his right hand here. This is, look, the right and left hand, he slips his feet. He just doesn't have the coordination. And when you release your hand like that, the power and energy and explosion and thrust. But as bad as the start was, his drive down the track was just as bad. Yeah. He was sideways like this two or three times up top. This is on the exit of wall, the snake, and, you know, Ivo.
Yeah. It'll be a run he's very happy to forget, I think, Ivo de Bruin. Next up, Rico Pater of Switzerland with Thomas Amrhein. Amrhein, the start and downtime record holder here after the Swiss Championships. But he didn't break Rico Pater, he broke for Gregor Bauman. So again, lots of changes in the Swiss setup.
Start time, not that bad. Peter, we did not see in North America. And Bauman, I don't think Bauman's in the field.
No, Bauman's not racing in the two-man. He raced in North America after sitting out the whole of last season. He got DQ'd in the race in Lake Placid, but he did not race in Winterberg. So clearly after the Swiss Championships, or at some way the points rankings have changed, Rico Pater gets the second Swiss spot, and Bauman, I'm sure, is back racing Europa Cup to try and overturn that.
Yeah, Bauman was here in four-man. He'll slide in four-man. He crashed in four-man practice. And, you know, Rico Pater gives up time at the start, and he's giving up more time in the drive down the track, too. This isn't smooth. 62 hundredths out. Could be 14th, probably 15th place.
Not bad speed, 139.4, tucks his head below the cowl, but outside the top 10 and quite a long way outside. So coach Eric Allard won't be looking as happy as he was last night at Prince Albert's party.
I would think, though, that he looks forward to the four-man, so I'm confused why he's not in the four-man competition.
Well, it looks like the Swiss have got a fairly strict regimen. Whoever's the top two sleds in points goes in that discipline.
Horseshoe, pivotal part of the track. You need to come in the curve absolutely perfect, no skid, and he's on the left side, wrong side of the curve to come in down the entrance, climbs high, needs to adjust and steer more than he should because he came in the curve late because of his mistake in the straightaway, and yada, yada, yada.
Well, great day for women's bobsledding in Switzerland earlier on, as Fabian Meyer led after the first heat, claimed the first Swiss women's bobsleigh medal, the first of her career at the senior level. Not a great day for Rico Pater. What about Oscar Kieber-Manis with Virus Leibombs, this new brakeman behind him? They too, like their teammates in Latvia 1, are vying for the fastest starters on the planet. 5.11 is the start record, 5.13. So again, John Morgan, so close at that front end of the field.
Thought we would see better start here, but the Latvians have been ushering a lot of new young blood into the program. And new brakeman was shot the other day, was a decathlete, was in London. I mean, all the best athletes in Latvia, track and field, wherever, they're in winter, they're coming to bobsleigh. And a good reason. They're good at it. Huge. I'd love the story. The fastest, biggest athletes in the United States or in the NFL. Fastest, biggest athletes in Latvia are in bobsledding. 2.5 million people live in that country. They dominate men's skeleton. They're formidable in men's two-man, four-man bob. And they put a lot of resource behind this. It's TV ratings in Latvia. Market share is unbelievable.
And you wonder why Latvia, of all the Baltic nations is so strong. And it's because when the Iron Curtain was up, the Russians used Latvian athletes and they built the track at Sigulda in Latvia as their training track. It was the Russians' home base using Latvian athletes. And all of that knowledge, experience, technology still exists.
84 Olympic Games, the first USSR medal, Zintis Ignatis, he's here. He was Latvian, but it was a USSR medal. Here's the exit of Horseshoe, really low. One of the lower sleds that we've seen. Look at this. Now he's going down, has to come back up. Watch the head. Head's really high there, too. Very surprised his head's that high. And he was late on that curve, that at the speed part of the track. But then the Russians went on to win the gold medal in four-man bobsled in 88. Jānis Kippers, he was Latvian.
Mm-hmm.
And so when the wall came down, the Latvians established their program.
In fact, the only Russian-born Russian to take an Olympic medal so far has been Alexander Zubkov.
A guy named Maris Boykins, though. I just remembered his name last night after I was having a discussion. He was one of the few Russians on that Latvian team, or the Russian team in 88.
With a name like Maris Boykins, he sounds like he was Latvian originally as well. Nikolai Estrati and Florin Krashuin, star draw number 19 for the Romanians.
Broadcast today on the Romanian TV. We saw the TV rights in the last 48 hours where Romanian TV has finally agreed to carry two-man bobsled and four-man bobsled the next 3 weeks, last 3 weeks of the year, which will be great for the Romanian athletes. They'll get some sponsorship, and boy, do they deserve it. No team comes to the table with more enthusiasm and less to work with than this country.
Best result of the season, 17th in his first World Cup race. That was in Park City, Utah.
Ninth place finish in the World Championships in two-man bobsledding in 2008 in Koenigsee, or 2011 in Koenigsee.
105.7, not great speed, I'm afraid.
No, probably in one of the oldest sleds in the competition, probably at DSG Dresden, or I didn't see the sled. I know their four-man is.
Yeah. Well, the Dresden Aircraft Factory, formerly still building sleds.
These are good lines, just nothing to work with.
Ooh, hit the inside of the final corner at Port Argo. 16th place, though, and at the moment they are in the race. With only three sleds going away, they are guaranteed a second run, and that's why the coaches were looking so happy. But he's only failed to make the cut once this season. He's guaranteed a second heat run here as well.
He'll be happy with that. This is the mistake that you brought in. Right down the middle, going uphill, finish curve. What's the high? How are you to get here? No, he dives out low. Then when he comes, dives out low, he misses. There's the finish line right there. So yeah, that cost him some time.
Two big hits. That really puts on the brakes to the line. But still, he's in 16th place. Next up, Edwin van Kalker. Brother Arnold on the back of the two-man. I think it's a very long time since we've seen Arnold on the back of a two-man sled. Sibrin Jansma injured in the two-man race last week and clearly still not fit enough to push. And Arnold taking
push
a long
bar.
While to get in. The driver's push bar didn't come down. First time of asking. Not the greatest of starts for the Dutch.
Okay, we'll look at the profile there. We see Arnold's shoulders in the back. That's number one.
Well, that's not necessarily a bad thing. I was talking to the British performance director, Gary Anderson. He said one of the things that stops drag, stops air spilling into the sled, is to wedge it full of muscle. Have the shoulders up against the cowl. It helps to clean up the airflow. So if you can see them sticking up above the driver, that's not great, but filling the frame.
I disagree. If you look at the other 25 previous sleds, look at the Germans, you don't see anybody back
there. That's what the wind tunnel tells you. Wide is good. High is not good. I agree with that.
Well, here's the 6500s down, and Edwin he'll be the first one to admit, I have to get better. He's not blaming anything on anybody other himself. He just is an athlete in a slump, and he says, I have to drive my way out of it. And you love his positive attitude at a time when, you know, things aren't going very well for him. And there's the coach's expression, Ivo Dalanovic on the left.
Do you know what? I think this is Edwin, his worst season ever. I can't remember a time where he drove anything like as averagely as he's driving this year.
He was always a top 10 athlete. And here's Nash Dixon entrance. Between Nash and Dixon. And look at this little skid here. Look at this. That's into Dixon. That's not the way you want to enter a curve.
Well, there's Edwin and Arnold, the two brothers. And this is just a season to forget for Dutch bobsledding, really is. They need to have a long look at their program. Alexei Stulnev with Nikolai Zhenilov behind him. And Nikolai making his first World Cup start here. Stulnev, 26 years old, the youngest of the three Russian sliders here.
This is the fifth different Russian driver we've seen in 2 weeks.
Yep.
We saw Papa or Pushnev last week, Pushkev, I think it was.
He only made his World Cup debut Pushkarev. In Winterberg last year. And so, yeah, the Russians mixing and matching a lot.
But the Europa Cup is going on right now in Innsbruck, in Eagles. Yep. And I heard his four-man team, or Kasanov.
Yeah.
Or no, not Zekharov's four-man team is down there in the World Cup in Eagles, and they'll be back here tonight to compete in the four-man World Cup tomorrow. So when the tracks are conveniently located, Innsbruck is about a two-hour drive from here. The athletes and the coaches take advantage of points.
Yeah. So double race weekend in Europa Cup, and then adding a four-man World Cup race. That's a great opportunity to really add to your points tally. And of course, the Russians are looking to keep their four-man tally up to keep three sleds in their Olympic allocation instead of allowing the USA to have three sleds. 105.7, not great speed from Alexei Stulnev.
Now the conditions of the track, it's warm. Coming late, we've already had two races, a skeleton and a woman's bobsled race, so you've had 36, 56, 84 sleds down the track, and what's he, the 20th? This is the 106, 104th sled down the track today. Look at him duck his head in there. Aerodynamics, he knocks out Ivo de Bruyn.
Yep.
He's now in 20th, and I don't know. He's got a chance, though. I think John Jackson, I don't know, is up to form. Jan Vibra could knock him out, but...
Well, two sleds to go. He is in the race, as you say, and Ivo de Bruyn won't get a second drive here. But with a little bit of a flaky run from Stulnev.
Look at his eyes turning to the left. Look at his head. Now look at the runner tips. Look at the runner tips. They're pointing down.
Big steer. That's a big steer. He's hauling
steer.
That off.
Yeah, and that's friction. Friction. Bobsledding is kryptonite to Superman. And it just doesn't work.
Alexei Stulnev is in the race in 20th place. Now for John Jackson of Great Britain, Bruce Tasker right behind him, still recovering from an Achilles tear during the summer post injury surgery. Jackson trying to find the speed and bring some four-man action.
JJ Jackson, Bruce Tasker.
5:26, their two-man start. And of course, with the other three horses behind him in the four-man, he's much more competitive at the start here with just Bruce to help him. He's still not firing on all 12 cylinders, John Jackson, so
no.
He needs to really drive up a storm here. But this has always been a pretty happy hunting ground for British drivers. Lee Johnson always loved this place.
Hey, and he was in top three or four position in the four-man world championships last year and fell to, I think, fifth, which was still a fantastic result. He had a great year last year.
Yes, he did.
Of course, this year we rip apart your Achilles and do what he's done and try and come out in the Olympics. For him to be here running around on a bobsled track with what he's done is absolutely incredible. And my hat goes off to him.
Not the greatest speed, 105.3 kilometers an hour. He is in 20th place off 17th best start, but he needs to be very clean down here to beat Alexei Stulnev. This might be very close. 136.9, slower than the Russian. Is the track dramatically slowing down towards the end of the run?
21st.
He is not in the race. He has only made the cut once this season in two-man. That is not Jackson's driving. That is the lack of speed that they've got at the start in this two-man, just haunting them all the way down the track.
He did some driving mistakes on the way down here that if he was perfect, he'd be in the field. And here's one of them. Watch as he crosses over here, and this is into Shamrock, I think, that tap. Now he's got to go in and steer again. He goes in there late. Look how late he is. And then he's still late coming over to this curve. And then what's that? You could have come out and probably drift over to the left-hand side and hit again. Well, you know, once you're late, when you're going 80 miles an hour, it takes you a while before you're unlate.
50 years ago, John, Great Britain won the two-man Olympic gold medal in Eagles with Nash and Dixon. But they don't make the cut here. Jan Verber of the Czech Republic then with his experienced veteran brakeman Dominik Suchý behind him. Let's see if Verber can bust into the top 20.
You know, you think back of him 3-4 years ago. I don't know how many kilos he's put on, but he's not that tall, thin athlete we used to see.
Yeah. Well, he's a sports instructor, 31 years old now, 6'1", 190 pounds. Only 88 kilos. That's not the heaviest athlete by some margin.
I think he's a little heavier than that. That might be some old information because he looked. I talked to him yesterday. He looked a little bigger than 188 pounds to me. But he made a big mistake up there, top of the track, up above S snakes. Here, 90 hundredths back speed, 105 and change. He's running about 20th place. If he's clean here in the bottom, he could move himself into a position to qualify. Ooh. He's the last person down of the run.
20 seconds.
Yep, he's falling off.
Not gonna have it unless he's nearly 140, and he's not close. 137.4 is not enough to see him in the race. Surely he comes across the line, 22nd place. So he joins John Jackson and Ivo De Bruin on the spectators bench as our fastest 20 will go through into heat two. They'll go in reverse order of their first heat performance. Both runs count. The total time decides who is the winner here in St Moritz. And Jan Werber getting a little sideways. A tap always throws the sled off the wall into a skid. And so the Czech Republic join the Netherlands and Great Britain in not having a second heat. One of the Dutch sleds goes through, the other does not. But our race leader is Germany's Francesco Frugic, the man who, with his brakeman Yannis Becker, who's with him again, won the two-man world championship here in February 2013. Less than a year later, he is leading the two-man race in January 2014.
Great lines.
Tenth of a second is the lead, John. That is matchable by Bert Hefti if he cuts out an error or two.
Yeah, this his race to lose, really, Frederick. It's close, though.
Top four, 1700s, they could all take a medal.
Holcomb could have got a chance.
Kasyanov and Spring, maybe.
Lyndon Rush had a great run. I really think Lyndon Rush was the guy. It was surprised to see him up there. Florschutz back in 12th. Suspect. Very suspect.
Bronze here last year in the two-man worlds. He's only 12th. And those that don't get a run, John Jackson, who was 4th, Werber and De Bruin, they also join him on the spectators bench. John Jackson 4th here in the four-man competition. So that's it. It is Francesco Frugic that will head our fast 20 as we go 20 down to 1 into the second heat here in St Moritz. Stay with us as we continue with our action live from Switzerland.